the week ahead. Monday, 13th of Feb, and you know, definitely markets putting a foot forward. Seems to be relatively positive general sentiment out there with regards to equities. If we just took a look at the DAX, for example, then the DAX this morning has opened kind of mid Friday's range, and we've just driven up and just had a little sneaky look at that top we had Friday morning, just above the 11,700 handle. Just fallen short of that, so nice resistance there for now. If we just look at the daily chart to get this in context, then you can see that this price point, Friday's high, was, let me just move that line, was somewhat of a top that we had back in January, the mid-January high. You can see we powerfully broke that on the 25th, and that set up the high of 2017. Just shy of the 11,900 handle. So there's room to move on the upside here this week, let's say, if we do get a break above Friday's high, and if markets do want to stay in a positive frame of mind, then technically we've got room to move higher for sure. I mean, a couple of things perhaps leading this, and if we just bring in the S&P here, got this on a slightly longer time frame. This is a 4-hour chart. And obviously we had a key break Thursday last week, big move, smashed the 2300 handle and really never looked back. And this morning we're chopping around, and overnight chopping around about Friday's highs without particularly pushing any further, but obviously big uptrend here. And you know, going into this week, I don't think there's any reason to expect anything different. I'd say there's a couple of things maybe just helping with the positive mood, you might say. And if we just firstly touch on the reason for that big move higher on Thursday last week, and this was Trump's comment about fiscal policy, and I've forgotten the word he used now. Phenomenal, there we go. So the key word of the week was phenomenal. This is when he was sat in a meeting with US Airlines, and he said to them, you can expect some phenomenal cuts to tax, some phenomenal changes to the tax landscape, and expect more on this in 2 to 3 weeks' time. So that was the comment. Well, we now know the date. When he vaguely said 2 to 3 weeks' time, well, he's, you know, the key big day for your diary, get it stamped in there right now, 28th of February. This is when Trump has planned to address a joint session of Congress, and one can only assume that, given his comment last week and his time frame of 2 to 3 weeks, one can only assume that this has been set up for him to address Congress on his fiscal plan and to really put forward his idea, put forward his bill, and then Congress will pick it up and see if they want to vote it through or not, of course. So 28th of Feb is now the big one with regards to more on the fiscal side. Another thing that has happened, which I think perhaps could be significant, well, significant-ish, another example of Trump kind of flip-flopping. Here is the man himself. Because what he said on Friday, well, he actually had a phone call with the Chinese president. And here's a little bit of an article on it. But he had a phone call with President Xi Jinping. And apparently the conversation was extremely cordial. And more importantly, Trump affirmed the US commitment to the One China policy. Now, definitely, I think, with regards to the foreign policy risk that Trump presents, then I think that it's the relationship with China that's absolutely top of the list, most important. And of course, in his campaign and after he's won the election, he's been critical, he's been aggressive in terms of suggesting China are a currency manipulator. He's been threatening 45% tariffs to be slapped on Chinese imports. He's then made a phone, one of the first people he phoned after winning the election was the president of Taiwan. This is the One China policy, by the way, in case you're wondering. Here's the Google definition. The One China policy is a key cornerstone of Sino-US relations. Although Taiwan's government claims it's an independent country, officially called the Republic of China, any country that wants diplomatic relations with mainland China must break all official ties with Taipei. So this is why it was seen as a big insult for Trump to call the Taiwanese Prime Minister, or President, sorry. Trump has commercial interests in Taiwan, and this was thought to be perhaps a catalyst for taking that relationship between China and the US south, and for it to be a trigger point for things to escalate, and maybe then we arrive further down the line with stuff like 45% tariffs and that kind of stuff. So it's actually quite interesting that Trump's he seems to be changing his mind a lot at the moment. That's because not only has he now seemingly done a U-turn with regards to China for now, he's also done a bit of a U-turn on his travel ban, because now he said there's no rush to appeal the travel ban. And so this idea that the travel ban was going to hit the Supreme Court and it was going to create obviously a media storm and most likely he was going to lose, Trump, perhaps his advisors have finally got through to him and he's now decided, well, there's no rush on this. So even though he tweeted after the last time he lost his appeal in the High Court, he tweeted, "See you in court." He tweeted that to basically the Supreme Court judges, "See you in court," implying, right, let's go straight away, Supreme Court, let's get this overturned. Seems like he's done a big U-turn on that now. Seems like he's actually admitted it's possible for him to lose. So, or what, perhaps his advisors have gotten through to him anyway. So look, these are a few things that are in the mix. So that's, if you like, that's a positive. Even that Supreme Court, even that the idea that Trump doesn't want to push this now, that's a positive for sentiment. And that's because all the flare-up and the negative press created by the travel ban in the first place was negative for risk. So you've got a couple of Trump-related things, the Supreme Court, you've got his relationship with China, and then the idea that on the 28th of Feb we're going to get more details. This is kind of driving, I would say, a continuation of what we saw at the end of last week, so positive-ish sentiment. What we do have this morning, though, is the dollar. Just check the dollar move. That's the other big thing. Stocks are nice and positive, but the dollar's weak. So the euro dollar's managed to get up through the pivot and actually then take out this top that we had on Friday, or I should say Friday afternoon's high. The high of the day Friday for the whole session was up just, well, I'll draw the line, here it is, 106.79, so still some work to do. So far we have traded entirely within Friday's range today, but certainly been a nice positive push. This is dollar weakness. If you have a look at the, let's check cable here. I got this on a longer time frame. Let me just go to a 30-minute chart, so it's on the same time frame as I was showing you for the euro dollar. So you can see that we've had a key break, and actually cable's trading up above Friday's levels. So again, dollar weakness, the theme of the morning. If you have a look at cable on a slightly longer time frame, though, just bear in mind where we are. Yeah, key break up through Friday's high, but look, Thursday's high is quite a bit higher. I guess before that you've got the high from the 7th, which was key resistance on the 8th as well of February, and that's around 125.50 on the futures, before you then have that high point from the 9th. But yeah, I just wanted to point out, in the grander scheme of things, we're actually mid-range here. The key range, you can see it really nicely defined by the 2nd of Feb top up at around the 127 handle, and the big sell-off down to 123.50. That's the kind of broader range, and we're in the middle of that right now. So just bear in mind the bigger picture. But certainly some dollar weakness this morning. This might be coming off the fact that the big event of the week is Janet Yellen. And Yellen is expected to show up on Capitol Hill. This will be for she's going to do it twice. Once in front of the Senate, once in front of the House, and so the big one's Tuesday. So Tuesday afternoon, this is her semi-annual testimony, where she delivers her assessment of U.S. economic conditions to Congress, and then justifies why they have the policy and the policy path that they have. And then, of course, she gets a grilling, and the senators, throw difficult questions at her, and she has to try and answer them. So it's always quite an interesting, definitely a big event. I'd say probably because of Trump's schedule with regards to his fiscal plan. So 28th of Feb, I think there's not too much new we're going to get out of Yellen, but perhaps a bit of dollar weakness this morning ahead of this. What we've had is Fisher. Here he is, Stanley Fisher, one of the key Fed members, of course, and he's said that there's significant uncertainty about US fiscal policy under the Trump administration. But he then did say the Fed would be strict in meeting targets of creating full employment and getting inflation to 2%. So we've got this idea that maybe what Yellen's going to do on Tuesday, tomorrow afternoon, is perhaps steer us away from a March hike idea. Don't forget, the next Fed meeting is middle of March, so we've got about 3 weeks or so. And she's probably going to say that it's a live meeting, and every meeting's a live meeting. That means that, on the face of it, they're trying to pretend that every meeting they can potentially raise interest rates. But of course, we know to look through and see through that. And ultimately, they're probably not going to be ready to hike rates in March. And the reason being, as Fisher said, we still don't know yet on what the fiscal plan's going to be. I don't think, until a fiscal plan has been voted through Congress, I don't think the Fed or anybody else are in a position to really make a clear judgment on how much growth acceleration we're to expect in the US, let's say in the second half of 2017. And no one's going to be able to have a clear outlook for inflation either until we know exactly the size of the fiscal package. So Yellen's tomorrow. Let's just have a quick update. We've had some data overnight. This is the Japanese GDP print, which has actually come in marginally lower than expected. So it was expected at plus 0.3, but it's edged down to plus 0.2. This isn't kind of, it's not major news, to be honest. Let me just flick to my next, I closed it by mistake, never mind, let's carry on. Fisher, I talked about. This is something else that's of interest in the press at the moment, overnight. It's just talking about US debt, and maybe this is linked to Trump. And this is the idea that there's a lot more selling now. And actually, if you look at this chart, this is looking at net change in foreign ownership of US treasuries. So this is thinking about the absolutely ginormous US debt market, where you've got almost $20 trillion sloshing about in US government bonds. And who owns it? Well, of course, the Fed own about $4.5 trillion. They're the biggest owner, but the second biggest is China's government, and the third is Japan's. But if you add up all the foreign owners and you compute the net change, well, actually, 2015 was pretty much flat, but 2016, you can see for the first time in decades, we've seen a net negative change in terms of foreign ownership of US debt. This is whilst the US debt pile has been getting ever bigger. So you've got to ask the question, why is this happening? Because if you just scroll down, from Japan's point of view, you've got a great yield differential between US 10-year and Japanese 10-year. Japanese 10-year yields are clocking in at about plus 0.1%, whereas US 10-years are, up around 2.3, 2.4%. You've got a huge differential, which makes this a sensible trade, doesn't it? Let's take our yen, let's sell yen, buy dollars, and then with our dollars we can buy US-denominated debt, which will give us a much higher yield than we'll get from Japanese bonds. So even though the yield differential seems to be in favour, we're still getting net outflows. And this is looking at the Japanese investors. And they sold their most US debt since 2013's taper tantrum. This is last month. So you're getting, why is this happening? There's two things, I guess. Has this accelerated since Trump's won the election? Because ultimately, the US are going to probably, in the near term at least, going to have to borrow more money to deliver any fiscal plan Trump's got up his sleeve. And they're already at $20 trillion. their debt levels are already well over above 100% of GDP, and are foreign investors beginning to think, hang on, the fiscal health of the US government is perhaps not on a sustainable path for the long term. That's one idea. Another idea is perhaps not so dramatic, and that's the idea that the US's influence on the global economy is on a downward trend. The US proportion of global growth, or the size of the global economy, is trending lower thanks to the giant emerging Asian markets mostly. But and, you know, you've got China, for example, wanting to diversify their foreign holdings from a currency sort of floating their yuan. They're looking at a more of a basket of currencies rather than the yuan being pegged to the dollar. And so, you know, this is leading to some selling of U.S. debt, and certainly China have been selling U.S. debt to try and prop up the yuan's value recently. So that's certainly a big part of these charts, I would say, especially into the end of 2016. But it's something to keep an eye on. When Trump rolls out his fiscal plan, you know, how are they going to fund it? And there's not much margin for error, because they're already 100% plus of GDP in debt. They're going to perhaps have to raise the debt ceiling above $20 trillion. And it might just bring the kind of fiscal health of the US government into the spotlight. Another quick one is regards to the FTSE 100. Talk in the press this morning that you're going to begin to see a breakdown in a very strong relationship. And that's been pound weakness and FTSE 100 strength. Okay, the FTSE clocked in at a new all-time high in January. This is thanks to big downside in the value of the pound since Brexit. But the FTSE is up 18%, okay, since June, but when you put it in dollar terms, it's only up 7%. So you can see it's a big currency play, but you're now getting speculators suggest that this, the very strong inverse correlation between the FTSE 100 and the pound is now going to begin to deteriorate. We've obviously got an inflation situation, and perhaps one of the more interesting bits of data this week is going to be UK inflation numbers tomorrow. And we want to see, you know, is inflation continuing to accelerate higher? And if it is, well, yeah, the pound's going to increase in value. And you're probably going to see the FTSE track lower as a result of that. And as we start to, and as Forbes said from the MPC last week, you know, we really need to start thinking about raising rates. So you might get some sterling strength, and that might well weigh on the FTSE. But more than that, I think you're having had the big, like, post-Brexit FTSE rally, almost indiscriminate, just buy anything in the FTSE 100, it's going up. I think now that kind of trade's done, and I think moving forwards, it's more about being more selective with your UK equity picks, rather than just assuming, well, the pound's going to weaken and everything's going to go up. But certainly inflation from the UK tomorrow is key. Let's have a look at the calendar for the week, first of all, here. Let me just bring this into play. So today's pretty quiet. I'll look at the calendar specifically for today in a minute. But Tuesday and Wednesday, very busy for data. Inflation data and foreign direct investment data out of China. We've got some big numbers from Germany with the preliminary reading for quarter four GDP. Also got ZEW economic sentiment. Then you got these big inflation numbers out of the UK. This is all tomorrow morning with the European flash estimate for GDP, industrial production and economic forecast. So busy morning tomorrow. In the US, data-wise, not that interesting, but it's going to be all about Yellen. This will be, it's normally, what, around about 3 p.m.? We'll check the timing, but it's definitely inside European market hours, this. So that'll be live from Capitol Hill, Yellen's semi-annual testimony. You get Lacker and Lockhart and Kaplan also talking. Wednesday, not so busy in the European morning, more about a US day for data, CPI, retail sales, Empire State Manufacturing, industrial production. Big numbers in here, definitely the retail sales particularly, and we want to see inflation. This is I'd say the key reading of 2017 is inflation. And, you know, just how quickly is it accelerating, and what's the Fed going to have to do about it? Same here in the UK. Same in Europe as well. You know, it's all about how steep is this inflation trajectory. Then we move into Thursday. You get some minutes from the ECB's meeting from 3 weeks ago, some housing data, Philly Fed data here, jobless claims, and then Friday, quieter UK retail sales, and then some minor data out of the US. If we just quickly look at today itself, then, yeah, quiet day. We've already had the Chinese data, of course, so actually it's a really quiet day. In fact, no real economic data of any note whatsoever. We've got some bond auctions down here. And still you got earnings season going on, but we've had enough earnings in now to really know what the state of play is after quarter four. So I'd say from a new scheduled news flow point of view, not too interesting. So that's why really you're getting almost, if you like, an extension of the kind of vibe that we had at the end of last week, with the equity market space looking to stay positive. You know, as I said earlier, I don't think there's any reason to expect these trends to change. Just look at oil. So I haven't talked about oil yet. Oil's actually on the back foot. Despite dollar weakness this morning, you're getting a technical break really below the pivot level and the overnight highs. You've perhaps got a level to look out for here, which was the top that we had back on Thursday. That's at 53.21. You had a nice push to the upside on crude and commodities more generally. I closed my chart, but I was going to show you a chart of copper. Copper had big upside into the end of last week, as indeed did most commodities generally, but the metals particularly big upside. We had some decent data from China on the trade front, perhaps crude oil just giving back some of those gains. I mean, we've seen from crude oil in recent weeks they're pretty much nothing but bearish US inventory data, but still this market climbs. And if you put it in the daily chart, just to remind you, I've said it a few times, but you know, the range we're operating in here is $55 to $50. And the key price point for this week, because Friday we almost got there but not quite, the key price point's the high of February, set on the 2nd, 54.34. Any break of that and VAS is in trouble, because I'll probably win my bet as we trade up to hit $55. But 54.34, important price for crude on the upside, okay? All right, I think I'll probably leave it there for now. Other than to just talk, actually I need to talk about T-notes. So T-notes suffered as we got this risk on US equities driving higher. You know, the big theme of last week, the end of last week, big upside for US stocks off these Trump comments. Well, T-notes went the other way and were camped out down around Friday's low here, around 124.20. If you look at this on a longer time frame, then you know, we've been quite sideways on T-notes for the last few months. I'd say the high last week, we did make a new high for the year, as you can see, sneaking up through the January top, but it looks to have been a false break here. And we'll see as this tracks back lower, prices down, yields go up, of course. The key price point in the medium term is 2017's low, which was set end of January. So there's plenty of room to move to the 124 handle and lower, but the Fed and Yellen tomorrow might be the most influential on that, of course. Right, I'm going to leave you to it, guys. Enjoy the week. Quiet day today, so I'd say stay patient. You're going to see perhaps the busiest day of the week tomorrow in terms of data and Yellen. So today's a day for just taking it cautiously. Don't try and force the market. If you're, you know, leave last week behind you. If you felt frustration and your P&L's not what you wanted it to be last week, you're not going to make up for that today. All right, you're not going to repair last week today, and that's because market movement's probably going to be subdued. So just be patient. You know, you start from scratch, you start from zero. Last week's irrelevant, and just trade this market on merit, and it's probably going to be a relatively quiet one. All right, enjoy the session, enjoy the week. Thanks a lot.